on va maintenant partir à l'étranger. Et sans doute, c'est un point commun très fort entre, évidemment, la fédération, la FFEA, l'EMU et la lettre du musicien, cette appétence pour l'international, que l'étranger nous apprend tant de choses, il faut aller à l'étranger. Chaque numéro de la lettre du musicien s'ouvre par un grand reportage à l'international. Mais maintenant, c'est Marie-Hédin Christophe qui va donner la parole à un grand nombre d'intervenants et surtout d'intervenantes venues de différents pays. Marie, c'est à toi pour enchaîner une partie plus féminine et plus internationale.
Thank you so much for this introduction, Antoine. So, I am back with you to hear different experiences from all over Europe. And I hope that this will be fascinating for you and very inspiring. We will hear about Spain, we will hear about Germany, we will hear about Austria and Croatia. We have four different speakers that are online with us, so hopefully we won't have too many technical issues. You know, let's have our fingers crossed, every one of you behind your screen. That would be very, I would be very appreciative. And so we will start with Spain. Let me introduce you Enric Aragonés Jove, who is a teacher and an education coordinator at the art center of L'Hospitale de Lobrega. And from his perspective, he will give us a little insight about cooperation between different institutions and how to enhance these different links and this idea of working together. Enric, the floor is to you. Can you hear me properly?
Yes, I'm hearing you, but I hear the translation at the same time.
So hopefully technicians will work on this.
Which is...
What you need to do is not to shut down the sound of your computer so that you can hear the questions that we will have for you later on. So just bear with us. This is your turn. You go ahead.
Je comprends le français aussi, mais j'entends le deux langues en même temps.
You go ahead.
Okay, but I still hear the translation. So,
hopefully you can manage to start your presentation so that you avoid hearing any other voice. Is that fine?
Okay. I'll try. Yeah, okay. Now, now that's right. Thank you very much. Thank you for the invitation. And okay. I realize now that I still hear the translation, so I'm going to turn down the sound. And when I finish, I'll...
Okay, in that case, just bear with us at some point because we will have questions for you. Okay, so
okay.
You have 14 minutes and then we'll be back.
Okay. Okay. I just close the sound and go ahead with the presentation. It's a pleasure to speak after all these dear colleagues. I'm very grateful for the invitation. I'll try to explain why the practice of arts is part of the cultural rights of people, and which is the role of music schools on the guarantee of this right. I'm finalizing an article on these ideas that will be part of the book Music Schools as Masters of Collaboration, edited by our colleagues from the University of Music and Performing Arts in Vienna. Can we go to the next slide, please? Thank you. Next. Thank you. Cultural rights are usually announced as the right to participate in the cultural life of the community. It is in the United Nations, UNESCO, European Union, many national laws and declarations. And this right is therefore active. We say participate in instead of being provided with, and collective, because we talk about the cultural life of the community. And to make this participation effective, and we can see the next part of the slide, one needs to know the many codes, manners, rituals, practices that constitute the cultural life and define the community itself. For everyone to have their own voice, not only a stage and a loudspeaker are required, but especially the language. And by language, we mean knowledge and skills. and also the awareness needed to make free and informed decisions. This is why cultural policies are and must be more and more oriented towards the development of capabilities rather than the supply of products. And if we accept that arts are part of cultural life in our societies, artistic knowledge and skills should be counted among the capabilities that need to be developed to guarantee these cultural rights. Jean-Luc Leroy have been talking on the impact on personal development and social behavior that music and arts can have. And I add here also the guarantee of cultural rights. Therefore, the practice of arts as a key element of these capabilities should be extended among the population. With that purpose, and we can see the next part of the slide, an initial contact with the arts is not enough. Everyone should be able to make free and informed decisions, and that is to decide whether or not to keep practicing, how long, how intensely, where, when. Real opportunities in cultural participation exist when each member of society is equally likely to follow any artistic path, any artistic activity, form, and intensity. But actually, and we can see that in the next slide, access to arts practice is not equally distributed. Statistics from the European Union show that educational attainment, income, and country of birth are factors that affect cultural participation, and also specifically the practice of artistic activities. Maybe we can see the three next parts of this slide. As some interesting data on these inequalities. Can we see the next? Okay. People with a tertiary level of educational attainment were found to be more than twice as likely to take part in cultural activities than people with a low educational attainment. And the highest cultural participation rates were recorded for people in the fifth income quintile, and the lowest cultural participation rates were recorded for people in the first income quintile. And the third draw we can see in this slide, native-born and EU-born populations were recorded almost identical cultural participation rates, while rate for people born outside the EU was lower. Therefore, the actions and policies for the extension of arts practice should aim to reach the maximum number of people, of course, but also all sectors and strata, especially those who, as we can see, would be less likely to practice arts. We can go to the next slide, please. Next one. Thank you. Next. The right to cultural participation appears here with a new form, a new concept, the right to all possible paths. A classical conception of arts education system oriented to professionalization, and the previous colleagues, the previous roundtable discussed about it, and can be represented by a pyramid with consecutive levels, what we could call a linear model, as we can see here. The only possible itinerary goes upwards, and only a few can reach the peak. At each step up, those who cannot go on are actually expelled, and if we go to the next part, we can see this, by the system, and will rarely find a way or a place to keep practicing arts. This progressive exclusion will be a reflection, again, of the previously mentioned inequalities, educational attainment, income, and migrant background. Even if we develop policies to ensure a first artistic activity for everyone, to widen the basis of this triangle, that structure does not ensure possibilities of taking different paths. Instead, we can see in the next slide, a whole new scheme must be considered. We can say now, if we press it in. A complex and integrated network where everybody can find their way to practice arts as amateurs, as professionals, as students, and all the forms in between those, and draw their own path here. What we suggest then is a transformation from an exclusive vertical conception towards an inclusive multidimensional one. We can go to the next slide. And we will focus on the two key elements of this change. Next. Sorry, I added a lot of animations in this presentation. Next one. The first one is the opportunity to keep practicing arts for everybody. Of course, not only a few, without losing people at every higher step. If EU-born citizens with higher income and educational attainment are much more likely to study arts in college, become professionals, or even create and engage in cultural NGOs than other people, it is not because some social strata entirely decide not to participate, but because the opportunities were unequally distributed. But the change we are proposing has another implication, as we can see here, number two, the creation of socially cohesive environments, as diversity in the society as a whole would be reflected in each group of the scheme, professionals, amateurs, amateur groups, higher education students, etc. All these groups should be as diverse as the whole society is. Consequently, this shift not only opens access to cultural participation, but also redefines cultural life and the community itself. The actions aimed at extend the practice of arts are mainly based on the collaboration of a basic binomial, as we can see here, education system and cultural institution. Education system has the children, the students. We can reach them all in schools. We have a whole public and spread network of professional teams, buildings, and institutions. And cultural institutions have the expertise, the professionals, the venues for art, and also the recognition for that, the reference. Cultural institutions, and an alliance between cultural institutions and educational institutions, between cultural and educational sectors, art centers and schools, contribute to a blurring of the boundaries between what is inside and outside the school. Those who usually operate outside the cultural institution can go inside the school to develop their own activity, to provide artistic expertise to an already established education system. However, not any use of arts or any form of collaboration between cultural and educational institutions strive for the same result and impact. Active involvement of children, culmination and exhibition in artistic results, the involvement of artists, all these are determining variables that give more value to this collaboration. Last but not least, arts programs in alliances between schools and cultural institutions must incorporate the perspective of the right to all possible paths, as we mentioned. And here is where I think music schools appear as a key actor. You can go to the next slide. Why I dare to say that music schools can have this this role? Because music schools have the expertise, the professionals and tools of a specialized cultural institution. But at the same time, they have the flexibility of even being an educational institution working mainly in a non-scholar field. Therefore, music schools can represent the embodiment of a connection between the realms of education and culture. And this idea does not imply that music schools are exempt of the need of collaboration, quite the opposite. They can play an articulating, facilitating role in this kind of alliance. And how do they can do it? There's infinite ways music schools can work with the cultural and educational systems with the purpose of extending the practice of the art.
Thank you so much, Enrique, for your contribution. I have a question for you. We just have 1 minute of question. It's very brief. So I have one question for you. You're very passionate apparently about social impact and music education or artistic education. How would you say this pandemic situation has impacted all these goals that you're trying to achieve in enhancing social equality through artistic change, artistic practice?
I think there's a key element. Is that the activity that music schools do is impossible to be transformed into a virtual environment. What we do in music schools is playing music together. And this is something that cannot be done in a virtual environment. We proposed activities for keeping this link alive
with
the students, the schools, the music schools, but in a non-physical environment, it's not possible to play together.
So let's hope that soon we'll be able to
stopped,
work physically together and
many activities,
have these
especially,
interactions.
Especially those who got to reach these potentially excluded people.